Now we discuss the boundary conditions. Last class we discuss the Maxwell's equations in matter, and now discuss the boundary conditions. Boundary conditions. So we have the equations, Maxwell's equations in matter as, del dot D is equal to rho f, first equation. Then the second equation is del dot B equal to 0. Then del cross E is equal to minus dou B by dou T, equation 3. Then del cross H equal to mu 0. Sorry, del cross H equal to J F plus dou D by dou T, equation number 4. So these are the Maxwell's equations in matter. This is differential form. So these four equations are represented in differential form. The same four equations I can represent in integral form as. The first equation, if I take in integral form, first equation, integral del dot D, if I take the volume integral of that one, so I am writing this one, taking the volume integral of, equation 1. If I take the volume integral of equation 1, then volume integral del dot D dv is equal to right hand side volume integral rho f dv. So right hand side rho f dv and left hand side del dot D into dv. So integral rho f dv, rho is volume charge density, free volume charge density, charge per unit volume. I am multiplying by dv and then integrating. So we will be having the total free charge. Then del dot D dv, this volume integral we can change into surface integral. So this, using divergence theorem, Gauss divergence theorem, we can change this into surface integral of d dot dA is equal to this one. This will be the total charge. So this is Q enclosed, Q free, QF enclosed. So integral QF enclosed is equal to QF enclosed is integral volume integral rho F dV, and volume integral del dot D dV. So this, using Gauss divergence theorem, this volume integral can be changed into surface integral D dot dA. So this first equation, so in integral form, here we are writing the equation in integral form. In integral form, we can write the first equation as D dot dA is equal to QF enclosed. So this is first equation. These are the equations we are going to write in integral form. Left hand side, they are equations in differential form, and this we are going to represent these equations in integral form. Second equation, del dot B equal to 0, taking volume integral, when I take volume integral, then integral volume integral del dot B is equal to dv, del dot B dv equal to 0, or using Gauss divergence theorem, integral surface integral B dot dA is equal to 0. So the second equation in integral form, we can write the second equation as integral b dot da is equal to 0. This is second equation. Now the third equation, del cross E equal to del cross E is equal to minus dou B by dou T, taking for the second equation, I am taking surface integral of this one. We are having del cross E, so taking surface integral, taking the surface integral of this equation. Left hand side we are having surface integral del cross E, sorry, del cross E dot dA is equal to right hand side minus dou by dou T of surface integral B dot dA. Del cross E using Stokes theorem, the surface integral can be changed into line integral. So integral del cross E dot dA, this is surface integral, is equal to line integral E dot dl. E dot dl, that line integral can be changed into surface integral as del cross E dot dA. So instead of this left hand side, I can take it as line integral E dot dl is equal to right hand side minus dou by dou T of, when you integrate this over B dot dA is actually the total flux. So the right hand side will be having rate of change of flux. Phi is varying with respect to time. So if I want, I can replace this dou by dou T by d by dt of flux phi. Phi is surface integral of B dot dA. We are performing integral over area. Then this will give the flux, total magnetic flux. Then magnetic flux, rate of change of magnetic flux. So this is minus d phi by dt, which is Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. So the third equation we can write it as integral E dot dl equal to minus d by dt of integral, this is surface integral and this one is line integral, B dot dA. This is equation number 3. Now the fourth equation is del cross H equal to JF plus dou D by dou T. Taking the surface integral, in the surface integral to the left hand side, del cross S dot dA, this is surface integral, is equal to surface integral JF dot dA. JF dot dA plus dou by dou T of surface integral D dot dA. So del cross A using Stokes theorem, we can change into line integral. So this is line integral of H dot dl. Line integral of H dot dl over the closed path is equal to integral JF dot dA will be IF enclosed, it is free current enclosed by the path, plus dou by dou T of integral D dot dA, that will be electric, D is electric displacement current density, and this will be integral D. When you integrate over area, this term will be a function of time, so time only. So we can write, instead of dou by dou T, we can replace it by complete derivative d by dt of surface integral d dot dA. So the fourth equation is in integral form. The fourth equation is line integral of H dot dl is equal to I free enclosed plus d by dt of integral. This is surface integral of d dot dA. So this one is equation 4. So these are the 4 equations in integral form. For most of the cases, we need the equation in differential form. That will be used for solving problems. When you want to find the boundary condition, we will take the integral equation. That's why I represented these equations in integral form. Taking the first integral equation is integral d dot surface integral d dot dA is equal to q free enclosed. Free charge enclosed by the surface. Consider a surface. So this surface, and here take an elemental part of the surface and take a pillbox surrounding elemental part of the surface. Here I am considering a small box like this. This is extending. Lower surface is below the surface of below the surface, and the lower surface of this pill box is below the surface. This is medium 2 and here medium 1, and the above this surface is above this one, upper surface, and this one is, this is below the actual surface. So I am considering an imaginary pill box. So take the normal. So this represent normal. So integral d dot dA, integral d dot dA, area, direction of area is area of this plane. Area of this plane is perpendicular to the surface. That n cap represents the direction of area vector. N cap represents the direction of area vector. If it is representing the direction of area vector in the outer surface above 1, we are having the electric displacement d1. Here the electric displacement is d1, and in the below surface, this 2, the electric displacement, let it be d2. Then integral over these two surfaces, this field, let the field is directing from 2 to 1. Let the direction of d is from 2 to 1. When you take the integral over the closed surface, this is actually over the closed surface. These surfaces, you need not take the integral over that surfaces. We are taking the width negligibly small. That's why its area will be negligibly small. This length is considerable, but this area of surrounding surfaces, these surfaces will be negligibly small. So if these surfaces are negligibly small, then you need not take the surface integral over these 4 surfaces. You only take the upper surface and the lower surface. I am assuming an infinitely small pill box. Its width is very small, length is considerable. This L, length is having a considerable length L, but this width is negligibly small. So this area, we can neglect this area, these 4 areas, and we only need to consider the upper surface and the lower surface. When you calculate the integral d dot dA in the upper surface, you can take it as d1, upper surface, d1 dot its area, I am taking it as A, d1 dot A. Then lower surface, the unit vector is pointing in the downward direction. Lower surface, the unit vector area, direction of area is pointing in the downward direction. The field D is in the upward direction. So we can write it as minus D2 dot A is equal to right hand side is qf, the charge enclosed by the surface. If I take sigma f as the surface charge density, surface charge density, and this surface is having an area A. A is the area of upper surface or lower surface, area of surface, then this will be enclosing an area A. So sigma f is surface charge density, then I can take total charge enclosed is equal to sigma f into its area is A. So we can write it as sigma f into area A. If the displacement is along the direction of area vector, so then this will be perpendicular to the surface. So I can take this as d1 perpendicular into A. This area vector, these two are along the same direction. So d1 perpendicular into A minus d2 perpendicular into A is equal to sigma f into A. So cancelling the area A, we can have d1 perpendicular minus d2 perpendicular equal to sigma f, where sigma f is the surface density of charge. So this is the first boundary condition, d1 perpendicular minus d2 perpendicular equal to sigma f. This equation, I am giving this as equation number 5. Now from the second equation, from the second Maxwell's equation, integral, line integral B dot dl, second equation is line integral, second equation is surface integral B dot dA is equal to 0, integral B dot dA equal to 0. In a similar way, we can write it as B dot B1 dot A minus B2 dot A is equal to 0. Or field perpendicular, area is perpendicular to surface. So we can write B1 perpendicular A minus B2 perpendicular A is equal to 0. Or we can write B1 perpendicular minus B2 perpendicular equal to 0. So the second boundary condition, we obtain it as B1 perpendicular minus B2 perpendicular equal to 0. Now the third Maxwell's equation, take the third Maxwell's equation. Third Maxwell's equation is integral line integral E dot dl equal to minus d by dt of surface integral B dot dA. We are taking line integral of electric field over a closed path. This surface integral we are taking over the closed surface. And now I take the line integral over a closed path. Consider the same surface. Consider a surface like this. So along this surface, if I take a closed path, some part is above. So this is length L, and some part is below this one. This also length L. This breadth is B. B is negligibly small. I'm taking the width B tends to 0. I am taking a closed path like this. So this is the closed path to the surface. And along the surface, through the surface, if I take B, this width tends to 0, then the area enclosed by this path will be negligibly small. If B tends to 0, then the area enclosed by the closed path, closed path, that closed path I am giving a name A, B, C, D, oh sorry, A, B is given here. So I give H as the width. H as the width. So this width is H. So if H tends to 0, the thickness tends to 0, the area enclosed by the closed path A, B, C, D, A will be 0. That means integral B dot dA, that will be equal to 0 since the area is 0. Left hand side, this we can split into 4 terms, along the path AB, along the path BC, along the path CD, along the path DA. But these length and BC and AD are negligibly small. So we need not consider the line integral over these two paths. We only need to consider the line integral over AB and CD. This AB and CD are in opposite direction. Let the electric field is acting along this direction. Let the field be along this direction. Here this is E1 and along this direction. Here this is second medium and this is first medium. So here it is E2. So in the lower part, the length element and E are in opposite direction. And in the upper part, the length element and E are in same direction. So E is opposite to length element. Here E is along the same direction as length element. So when you take this integral, the four terms, two terms will be 0. And we need to calculate along the length CD and along the length AB. CD you can write it as E1 dot L, upper part, minus in lower part you can take it as E2 dot L is equal to right hand side it is minus d by dt of integral SB dot dA. I already told this term can be taken as 0. So if I take this to 0, then this will become E1 dot L. So the component of electric field parallel to the length. Component of electric field parallel to the length, we can take it as E1 parallel into L. E1 parallel into L minus E2 parallel into L. That is equal to 0. Or we can take it as E1 parallel minus E2 parallel equal to 0. So this is the third boundary condition. E1 parallel minus E2 parallel equal to 0. So this is equation number 7. Now take the fourth Maxwell's equation. What is fourth Maxwell's equation in integral form? Integral over the closed path, line integral of H is equal to I free enclosed by the path plus d by dt of integral, this is over the surface integral d dot dA. So this one is fourth Maxwell's equation. And in similar to this equation, we can take the line integral over the path. So this will be H1, upper side and lower side. Upper side along the surface, if I take the surface, I am taking a closed path like this. This is length L and this H tends to 0. Half part is below this one and the field is, so along this is upper part 1, lower part 2. Upper part, this field I am taking H1, and lower part this field is taking H2. Here the length is in opposite direction. This is L and here length is in this direction, and we are having current crossing across this. So this closed path, the current enclosed by the closed path is this one. And this integral, surface integral of, if I take infinitesimally small thickness, H tends to 0, then integral D dot dA, is equal to 0. Earlier we have taken integral b dot da equal to 0. In a similar fashion, we can take integral d dot da equal to 0. So this term becomes 0. Now I free enclosed here, the current is passing through an area, so we should take the current density as surface current density Kf. So we can take this free current enclosed If enclosed in terms of the current density K, so that we can take it as, earlier we have taken that equation K cross N dot dl, integral of this one. So line integral of K cross N dot dl, that will represent the total current. K cross N, N is unit vector perpendicular to this surface. N is a unit vector perpendicular to this surface. So K cross N, K is along this direction. K is along this direction. So this is the direction of K. Current density is along this direction. So K cross N will be along the line, L. So this is K. Vector K is along the direction of current, and N is perpendicular to the surface. If K is along this direction and N is perpendicular to this direction, then take K cross N. K cross N will be perpendicular to both K and N. That will be along this direction. This direction is the direction of length L. So this will be K cross N, K into unit vector 1 into N, and K is making 90 degree angle. So this is sine 90 is 1. So 1 into dl. So this will be KdL, integral KdL. Integral KdL means K into, if K is same throughout this length, then it will be K into L. So I enclosed is, if you know the current per unit length as K, then it will be K into L. Or in general equation, we can write it as K cross N dot dl. If K cross N is constant, or in other words, we can write this equation as IF enclosed equal to K cross N. If it is constant, then you can take K cross N dot integral dl. This equation you can write in this form. If L is total length, then integral dl is L. So I can write IF enclosed as K cross N dot L. We can also write this current as K cross N dot L. So this equation, last term becomes 0. IF enclosed, I can write it as K cross N dot L, and integral H dot DL, we can split into four terms. So this is L, and upper part we are having H1. In the lower part we are having H2, but the lower part, the length is opposite to H2. This one length and this one length, A, B, C, D. AD and BC are, their length is H is tends to 0. So when you calculate the line integral over the four elements of this path, you need not consider AD and BC. You only consider AB and CD. Along AB, H2 and L are in opposite direction, and along CD, H1 and L are along the same direction. So left hand side of this equation, integral H dot DL, you can write it as LHS of this equation. Left hand side of this equation, integral H dot DL, you can write it as H1 dot L minus H2 dot L is equal to, right hand side, first term, IF enclosed, you can write it as K cross N dot L. K cross N dot L plus last term is 0. So you will be having h1 dot l plus, sorry, minus h2 dot l equal to k cross n dot l. K cross n dot l. So on simplifying this equation becomes h1. So if field is parallel to length, then we can write h1 parallel into l minus h2 parallel into l is equal to k cross n. K cross n, if k and n are perpendicular, then this will be k into dot l. K cross n is along the direction of l. So k cross n is along the direction of l, so they are parallel, then this dot product cos 0 will be 1. So we need to write k into 1 into l. K into 1 into l. So this l will get cancelled, so we will be having this free current density. So I am writing this k as kf, free current density. So we are having h1 parallel minus h2 parallel equal to kf. H1 parallel minus h2 parallel equal to kf. Equation number 8. So we have obtained the boundary conditions as, therefore, the boundary conditions are, first boundary condition, which one is first boundary condition? First boundary condition is d1 perpendicular minus d2 perpendicular equal to 0. The second boundary condition is B1 perpendicular. Second boundary condition is B1 perpendicular minus B2 perpendicular equal to 0. This is second boundary condition. Third boundary condition is E1 parallel minus E2 parallel equal to, sorry, first boundary condition is not equal to 0, it is sigma f. Am I right? First boundary condition is d1 perpendicular minus d2 perpendicular sigma f. Second is b1 perpendicular minus b2 perpendicular equal to 0. b1 perpendicular minus b2 perpendicular equal to 0. Third boundary condition is e1 parallel minus e2 parallel equal to 0. Fourth boundary condition is, this is third one. Fourth boundary condition is this one. Fourth boundary condition is h1 parallel minus h2 parallel equal to kf. These are the boundary conditions. These are the boundary conditions in dielectric medium. When electric and magnetic field vectors crosses a dielectric medium, we are having the boundary conditions like this. Now these field vectors for linear dielectric medium, these boundary conditions can be written as, for linear dielectric medium, for linear dielectric medium, d equal to epsilon e and h equal to b by mu. So D1 will be epsilon 1 E1 and D2 will be epsilon 2 E2. So this equation, first equation can be written as epsilon 1 E1 perpendicular minus epsilon 2 E2 perpendicular equal to sigma F. Now B1 perpendicular minus B2 perpendicular equal to 0. E1 parallel minus E2 parallel equal to 0. Now, H, instead of H, we can write it as B1 parallel by mu 1 minus B2 parallel by mu 2 equal to KF. So, these are the boundary conditions for linear dielectric medium. So, these equations, these set of equations, I am writing these equations as equation number 8 and all these equations, equation 9, and all these equations, I am writing this as equation 10. So, these equations are the boundary conditions for linear dielectric medium. Now, in particular, if there is no free charge and no free current at the interface, in particular, if there is no free charge and free current at the interface. If there is no free charge and no free current at the interface, then we can write the boundary conditions as these boundary conditions. Sigma F becomes 0, KF becomes 0. Sigma F equal to 0, KF equal to 0. So, these boundary conditions becomes epsilon on E1 perpendicular minus epsilon to E2 perpendicular equal to 0. Second equation is E1 parallel minus E2 parallel equal to second equation B1 perpendicular minus B2 perpendicular equal to 0. B1 perpendicular minus B2 perpendicular equal to 0. Third equation is E1 parallel minus E2 parallel equal to 0. And the last equation is B1 parallel by mu 1 minus B2 parallel by mu 2 equal to 0. So, these are the boundary conditions for a dielectric medium if there is no free charge and no free current. Or we can write these equations as epsilon on E1 perpendicular equal to epsilon to E2 perpendicular. B1 perpendicular equal to B2 perpendicular. E1 parallel equal to E2 parallel. B1 parallel by mu 1 equal to B2 parallel by mu 2. So, we will be using these equations as boundary conditions for a linear dielectric media where there is no free charge and no free current. So, these are the boundary conditions, and these equations are the basis for the theory of reflection and refraction. We will use these theories. These boundary conditions are used for deriving the theory of reflection and refraction. Okay, thank you.